And I have the distinct privilege of introducing our next speaker. Adam Andrzejewski is the founder and CEO of OpenTheBooks.com and the author of Operation Drain the Swamp, released by Encounter Books. Prior to starting Open the Books, Andrzejewski, an entrepreneur, co-founded Homepages Directories, a $20 million publishing company. Since 2014, Andrzejewski has been a senior policy contributor at Forbes, publishing 200 investigations for 16 million views. His findings exposing government waste, fraud, corruption, and taxpayer abuse have appeared at the BBC, USA Today, ABC World News, ABC Good Morning America, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, Chicago Tribune, The Boston Globe, C-SPAN, and NPR. Andrzejewski's federal oversight work was included in the President's budget to Congress in fiscal year 2021. The budget cited his organization by name, bullet-pointed their findings, and hyperlinked to their report. He appears regularly on the national desk at Sinclair Broadcast Group, Fox News, Fox Business Network, and has appeared on the BBC, Hearst TV, Cox Broadcast Group, Newsmax, and One American News Network. Please join me in welcoming Adam Andrzejewski.
Well, it's great to be here. Thank you, Governor Scott Walker, Michael, Raj, Jamie, Kyle. Thank you for this opportunity to share our mission and vision. And thank you to each and every one of you for taking time out of your busy college schedule right before finals to come here to Dixon, Illinois, to Ronald Reagan's boyhood home for this wonderful conference. Before I get into the subject matter of what I want to talk to you about today, I just want to take a moment and share my personal story with you. I'm from Illinois right here, and it is the Super Bowl of corruption. If anything happens for the good of the people in Illinois, it is entirely by accident. And on my mother's side of the family, we've been here in this area, in the Dixon area, not too far from here, within about a 30-mile radius, since 1844. So my roots in Illinois, as a family, run deep. It's eight generations on the family farm. It's still in we're a land-grant family in 1844, and it's still in our family. My uncle still owned that property. I grew up in a small town of Hersher, Illinois, population 1,200 people. Two roads in, two roads out, no stoplights to this day. And I grew up walking beans to tasseling corn and baling hay. It's how I developed my work ethic. I went right to college down the street in DeKalb at Northern Illinois University, the state school. My brother followed me there. He went on to Harvard Law School. When he graduated from Harvard Law School, my brother and I went into business together. And here's the story. As entrepreneurs, we started our business from scratch from our apartments, and over the course of a 10-year period, we grew that business from zero in revenue to $20 million in revenue, and over that 10-year period, we were an overnight success. But that's not the story. Here's the real story. At the end of the first year, everything that we had saved in life, which was about $100,000 between us at the time, we were upside down. In year three, when we should have been celebrating $1 million worth of sales revenue that year, we nearly lost the business because we ran out of money. As an entrepreneur, everyone gets paid first, you get paid last, if at all. By the fifth year, we were making a little bit of money, and my brother would call me with a capital call. And what that means is, it's you have to put what you've earned back into the company to help grow the company. In the sixth year, that was the first year my brother and I out-earned our employees. This is sacrifice. This is capitalism. It's the honing of an individual. By year 10, so in year six, we were a $5 million company. And by year 10, we were that $20 million company in an overnight success. But the reason I fight so hard on government spending is because at the end of year three, but for another dime's worth of taxes, regulations, or fees, we would have been gone as a business. It was that close. We eventually created hundreds of jobs. Our average sales rep was a woman, and she made more than the average doctor makes in Illinois at that time. These were good jobs. And if the heavy boot of Illinois or the federal government was any stronger, it would have crushed our company in year three. That's why I fight so hard that when government takes a piece of your liberty on taxes and they spend that, they better spend it to help people who have real needs. They better spend it efficiently, frugally, and to help those people. So in 2011, I founded an organization called OpenTheBooks.com on that basis to fact check politicians and make sure that they were spending our tax dollars frugally, honestly, and helping people that have real needs. Now, if you think about it, over the course of the last 20 years, the size, scope, and power of government at all levels has grown so substantially at the federal level, the state level, and the local level. And I know of no better example to illustrate this than the Ivy League colleges. We did an oversight report from our auditors at OpenTheBooks.com a couple of years ago, and here's what we found. That in a recent 6-year period, the 8 schools of the Ivy League collected $42 billion on government subsidies, special tax breaks, and federal contracts and grants. $42 billion. Just on contracts and grants, it was $25 billion, and we compared that up to the amount of student tuition the 8 schools had collected over that 6-year period, and it was only $22 billion. Today, the Ivy League is more federal contractor than they are educator. Then we looked at their grants, and we found a lot of waste. Cornell University, they took a $1 million grant. Where it hurts the most to be stung by a bee. It's the nostril, by the way. I read the study. Columbia University, they took $5.6 million to create fake voicemails from the year 2065 after the world's been decimated by climate change. And look, the Ivy League, they don't need taxpayer help. 2 years ago, their endowment was $144 billion collectively. And last year, at OpenTheBooks.com, published in my then column at Forbes, we revealed that it had collectively grown in 1 year from $144 billion to $192 billion. By the year 2048, the Ivies are going to have a $1 trillion endowment, and they don't need taxpayer help. I am hopeful and optimistic about our future, even though I live in Illinois, and even though we are dedicated to holding government accountable. Now, in Illinois, I think we have a special perspective because of our reputation on government corruption. In a recent period, not 4 out of our last 9 governors spent time in the federal penitentiary. 2013 was a particularly bad year. We had a governor, 1 Republican, and 1 Democrat in federal prison at the same time. It was Governor Republican George Ryan and Democratic Governor Rod Blagojevich. And I remember when one of our most famous citizens here in Illinois, Rahm Emanuel, in 2011, he ran for mayor of Chicago. And Rahm ran on a good government platform. Rahm promised to end pay-to-play in the city of Chicago. You know what pay-to-play is. It's when you give campaign cash and you expect a city contract. And sure enough, when Rahm won in 2011 as mayor of Chicago, he issued an executive order banning campaign cash from city vendors. So when Rahm was running again in 2015, I received a call from the Emmy Award-winning journalist John Stossel, who was then at Fox News. And Stossel asked me if we could fact-check Rahm Emanuel's promise. And I said, yes, we can. And what we did is we took the City of Chicago checkbook, we matched it up with Rahm Emanuel's campaign donor disclosures, and this is what we found. 600 city vendors gave Rahm Emanuel $7 million in campaign donations, and they had received $2 billion in city payments. In God we trust, Illinois politicians, we must audit. And again, I'm hopeful and optimistic about our future. Why? Because in the last 5,000 years of human history, you and I have been given one of the greatest gifts. And it's a constitution that recognizes that our rights come from God, they don't come from government. And our founders recognized this. And they realized that the citizens needed the tools to hold the government accountable. The government that was instituted to secure our rights, our founders gave us the tools to hold it accountable. Because they recognized that knowledge is power. And they wrote it into the United States founding documents. And it's Article 1, Section 9 of the United States Constitution. And it says that a regular statement and account of the receipts and expenditures of all public money shall be published from time to time. And today, there is a clear interpretation. Post every dime online in real time. Open the books. And that's our mission at OpenTheBooks.com. It's to take every dime taxed and spent at every level of government across the entire country, capture it, put it online, so people for free can see what's going on locally and hold the political class accountable for tax and spend decisions. Now, to that end, last year, my organization filed 47,000 Freedom of Information Act requests. It was the most in American history. We successfully captured $12 trillion worth of government spending at every level, federal, state, and local. Within your universities, we have virtually every dime online in real time, in as real time as possible. And what that means, we have the salary payroll file. You can look up your professors if you're in a public university. You can look up the vendor checkbook spending of your university. If you have questions about a vendor serving your college, if you're at a public university anywhere in this country, we probably have all of that for free on our website at OpenTheBooks.com. Here's what our data is comprised of. Number one, nearly the entire payroll file of all public employees at every level of government across the entire country. 25 million records just last year, federal, state, and local. If your parents are worried about holding their local K through 12 school district accountable, we've got the payroll file in virtually every single school district in the country on our website. Checkbooks. We have the federal checkbook back to the year 2001, and in the states, we've got 49 out of 50 state checkbooks. We're only missing California. Many of those records go back an entire decade. Local units of government. Not only do we have their payroll files, I don't care if it's your local township, county, city, school district, mosquito abatement district, but we have a lot of the checkbooks as well. In 15,000 local units of government, we have the vendor spending online. In 4,000 K through 12 school districts, we have the vendor spending online so you can follow the money, so you can start holding your political and elected officials accountable for how they spend your tax dollars. All right, I'm going to give you two recent examples of how our data was used to hold politicians accountable. Number one, New Orleans in the police department. There was a whistleblower in the New Orleans Police Department that knew something wasn't right. So he came to OpenTheBooks.com just to check out the City of New Orleans Police Department payroll. And he found that sergeants who have a base salary of about $80,000, they were getting paid north of $200,000. And so he kicked off an investigation. And it has led to a big scandal in the New Orleans Police Department. Here's what he found. He found abuse within the police detail. Within the paid police detail. So for example, he partnered with a local TV station. They set up a sting on one of the officers' home. While he was being paid on a police detail, he was walking his dog and taking out his trash. One of the officers, who at the time was being paid to be behind the wheel of his squad car, was actually a couple of miles away down at the local racetrack, and he was behind the wheel of his race car. And this kicked off an FBI investigation, and 26 officers in the New Orleans Police Department have been suspended from police detail work. And hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars, are at stake, and it's a serious investigation. And this shows you the power of transparency. Here's the next example. In August, you and I watched as the Taliban started to overrun Afghanistan. And immediately, our auditors at OpenTheBooks.com, we had a question as to just how much U.S. taxpayer-paid military gear was going to be left behind. And so immediately, we went to work on this. And we broke the story, which was national and international news. And the figure was $82.9 billion worth of U.S. provided weaponry to the Afghan National Army and the Afghan National Security Forces and training. Let's break that number down a little bit. It was 600,000 weapons. That's 350,000 rifles, M4s, and M16s. It was 65,000 machine guns. It was 22,000 grenade launchers. We left behind 75,000 military vehicles. That's 50,000 light and medium tactical vehicles. It was 1,000 mine-resistant vehicles. Each mine-resistant vehicle cost between $300,000 and $750,000. We left behind 16,000 night vision devices and thermal imaging devices. If we ever go back into Afghanistan, we have lost the nighttime advantage, and it will take a cost of United States military soldiers' lives and other equipment. In Afghanistan, here's how it worked. A great example, drones. Back in 2016, the Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction found that $174 million worth of U.S.-provided drones had just disappeared in Afghanistan. Nobody knew where they were. They weren't being used. They couldn't locate them. So we looked through every single president's budget up through the latest budget here in FY 2022, which Biden submitted, and every year, millions of dollars worth of drones were back in the budget. They lost, nobody knew where they were, $174 million worth of drones, and yet millions of dollars of drones provided by the taxpayer were flowing back into the country. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through three action steps that you guys can take immediately on your own college or as you go through your young adult lives. Number one, insist that the books are open. And I'm talking all public spending, the payrolls, the checkbooks, the credit cards, the paid time off banks, all the benefits, the pensions. Insist that the books are open. Down in the red state of Texas, in Florida, I can't tell you once a public employee retires what their taxpayer provided retirement, golden parachute retirement pension plan payout is for the rest of their life. It's not subject to open records. But in Illinois, in California, in New York, in Oregon, for crying out loud, these are union stronghold states. That is a part of the public record. I can tell you when somebody retires, for instance, a superintendent here in Illinois, there are superintendents retiring on $300,000 a year. So insist on open records. Number two, hold the political class accountable for tax and spend decisions by declaring war on waste. And if you ever run for office as an executive, I encourage you to make this as a part of your platform. At USA Today and the Wall Street Journal in 2018 and 19, we ran double-facing page advertisements and an open letter to President Donald Trump, encouraging him to embrace the transparency revolution and declare war on waste. The first part of that letter was a 4-point plan to embrace the transparency revolution and to carve waste out of federal spending. The second page was 100 outrageous examples of federal waste. Here are just two of those examples. NASA gave a $1 million grant to prepare the nation's religions for the discovery of extraterrestrial life. HHS gave a $1.4 million grant to teach sex education to California prostitutes, who could probably teach the class. Today, here's an example of federal waste out of the COVID aid bills. At the peak of the pandemic, when the nation was suffering under an economic lockdown, Congress provided a lifeline to mom-and-pop businesses on Main Street. Those entrepreneurs, those hardworking men and women whose businesses were shut down because of the lockdown. Congress provided over $700 billion in this program called the Paycheck Protection Program, PPP for short. So just how much waste could be inside $700 billion? Well, here's a great example. The Small Business Administration ran the program, and they forgot to check the Treasury Department's do not pay list. So the SBA paid 56,000 businesses on the Treasury Department's do not pay list, and they paid them $3.5 billion. What's the purpose of a do not pay list if you don't check the list? If you're not checking the list and you're cutting the checks, $3.5 billion went out the door. Okay, so point number one is insist on open the books. Point number two is declare war on waste and hold politicians accountable for both of those points. Here's the third point. Insist that Congress read the bill. So at openthebooks.com, we've got a petition called Read the Bill, that Congress, after the final version of legislation, we have to take at least 72 hours, a timeout, a pause, to allow the people, the politicians, the pundits, to simply read the bill. A year ago in December, so December of 2020, that omnibus spending bill was 5,600 pages. The first draft of the social and human infrastructure bill last August was 2,400 pages. That eventually became the Build Back Better bill. When's the last time you read 10 books? So Congress dropped that bill in August, and our auditors at openthebooks.com, we actually read through the legislation, and we found on page 168 the enforcement mechanism for President Joe Biden's vaccine mandate on private employers with 100 or more employees. And here's what we found, a 10-fold increase in the amount of fines that the regulatory agency OSHA would be able to levy on America's small businesses, up from $70,000 on a maximum amount to $700,000. The president was serious about enforcing his edicts. If you didn't comply, they were going to bankrupt you. Thank God the Supreme Court came in and stopped that vaccine mandate on private employers with over 100 employees. Okay, at the federal level, there's a war on transparency. I'm going to walk you through some of these things. Okay, every year we file a payroll request for the 1.4 million bureaucrats who work in the 122 executive agencies at the federal level. And we were disappointed in the last year, 2016, of the Obama years, that they redacted 3,500 names from that responsive record. And when Trump came into office, we were hopeful and optimistic they'd give us the whole unredacted payroll. But the first year that we got the payroll through the door, the Office of Personnel Management redacted 256,000 names, and we estimated $20 billion of federal payroll was hidden in the swamp. The next year, in 2018, they redacted 350,000 names, and we estimated that $30 billion was hidden in the swamp. And that continues to today in the Biden administration. They're redacting 350,000 out of 1.4 million names from the federal payroll. We know that in 120 of the 122 largest federal agencies, the average salary now is six figures, 100,000. We know that if you hit your three-year anniversary as a federal bureaucrat, you get nearly nine full weeks of paid time off. Holidays, sick days, vacation days, 44 days of paid time off. And we estimate that small benefit costs the American taxpayers about $25 billion a year. Because if, when people have that much time off, your payroll headcounts have to increase. At the federal level, even though taxpayers fund it and guarantee it, we don't get to see the golden parachute pension payouts when a federal public employee retires. And that law needs to be changed, especially for our members of Congress. It's considered private information. I mean, nothing broils taxpayers' blood more than when their member of Congress retires and we don't get to see their lifetime retirement payout from their pension. Bonuses. We know that there are 1 million performance bonuses at the federal level, and that costs the American taxpayer every year $1.1 billion. And even though they're, you know, I mean, that I guess kind of mystifies some people too. You're probably asking yourself, Adam, how can a million bureaucrats get a performance bonus? I don't think the federal government's running that well. I agree with you. We dug a little deeper, and we found that 99.6% of all federal employees are rated fully successful. And that's actually impossible. The advertised purity of Ivory soap is 99.6%. So a million bureaucrats get a bonus for $1.1 billion, but I can't tell you individually who gets the money, because our right to know was negotiated away in the union contract. So the unions put the clause in their contract that the recipients of performance bonuses is private information, and that needs to change as well. Okay, let's go through the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve responded to our payroll request and hid 98.3% of their payroll. They have about 22,000 employees, and they provided 269 salaries to us. The rest of them, they said, is private information. And we vehemently disagree with that. They're paid for by taxpayers, and we get to see it, although we're gonna have to sue for it. Federal Reserve also said when we filed for their checkbook that they don't have one. Yes, the Federal Reserve doesn't have a checkbook according to their response to our Freedom of Information Act request. But they said that if you have questions about an individual vendor, we'll provide you what we paid them. And my answer to that was, if you can search for a vendor, whatever you're searching, we want a copy of that. And again, no response, so we would have to sue them. Here's another office where there's a war on transparency, and it's the Office of Vice President, a heartbeat away from the presidency, and they claim that they're not subject to the Freedom of Information Act over at Kamala Harris's office of vice president. But she's the president of the Senate, and somehow they disclose their payrolls over on the Senate side, so we grabbed it over there. All right, you tell me, what government program is running well? We've got a lot of students here from the Midwest. Could it be farm subsidies? In urban areas where there are no farms. We did an oversight report on Washington, D.C., Chicago, and New York City, and it was flush with farm subsidies. But my favorite story is right here in Chicago. I guess the corruption stories in Illinois, they're always better than anywhere else. And it's the Reverend Minister Louis Farrakhan, the founder of the Nation of Islam, in a 17-year period mailed to his home in Hyde Park, Chicago, was $370,000 in federal farm subsidies. What government program is running well? Could it be health care over at Veterans Affairs? So we did an oversight report on the VA. You might remember back in 2014, the big scandal at Veterans Affairs when up to 1,000 sick veterans died because they couldn't get in to see a doctor on a timely basis. They were put on wait lists, and the nexus of the scandal started at the Phoenix VA facility, where up to 40 veterans died while they were on the waiting list. So we're holding the federal payroll. We took a look at how many employees were employed at the Phoenix VA. 3,100. How many were doctors? 223. Are these medical systems? Are they employment farms? Fast forward to today. Congress threw billions and billions of dollars at the VA. From 2012 through now, the VA has added 106,000 positions. Yet only 6,700 were doctors. And you've got places like down in Atlanta where the average veteran still waits 6 months to see a doctor because there aren't enough doctors. And this can't be the end of the story. Our veterans fought for us, they deserve basic health care, and we need to fight for them. Really quickly, I'm gonna just walk you through the American Rescue Act waste, right? In the American Rescue Act that passed in March of last year, they tucked $350 billion in there to bail out states and localities. So let's walk through some of this. The red state of Utah was running a $1.5 billion budget surplus. Congress bailed them out for an additional $1.5 billion. Texas was running a $1 billion surplus, and Congress bailed out the state government in Texas for an additional $17 billion. The blue state of California was running a $26 billion budget surplus at the state level, and Congress bailed out you and I, our tax dollars, for another $76 billion. When George W. Bush came into office, the national debt was $5.8 trillion. When Barack Obama left office, the national debt was $19.9 trillion. When Donald Trump left office, the national debt was $28 trillion. And now with Biden, we're north of $30 trillion. RDRD. They're spending too much of our money. All right, I want to get into the latest battle that we've been on for the last 15 months. We do a lot of oversight at OpenTheBooks.com. Last year, we did 300 investigations. Here's one of them. In January of 2021, we got our federal payroll data through the door. And we quickly realized that the number one most highly compensated federal employee was Dr. Anthony Fauci. And he made $417,000. He out-earned the president, four-star generals in the United States military, all 4.3 million of his colleagues at the federal level. And people had questions. How can a sub-director, a director of a sub-agency, of Health and Human Services earn the most? You got Health and Human Services, you got National Institutes of Health, and 27 sub-agencies. Fauci's one of them. How can he earn the most? So he filed Freedom of Information Act requests for his contract, for his conflict of interest documents, for his financial disclosures, his ethics disclosures, for his royalties, for a hush agreement, a confidentiality agreement, if any. We filed those requests. And NIH produced virtually nothing to our auditors over a 10-month period. So using Judicial Watch in October of last year, we sued the National Institutes of Health. The National Institutes of Health admit to holding 1,200 pages subject to our request and our lawsuit. And still, on judicially mandated production, they have still produced virtually nothing, and today is April 9th, 2022. You'll remember this hearing in January when U.S. Senator Roger Marshall is questioning Dr. Anthony Fauci in the Senate hearing. Fauci's under oath, and Fauci says, yes, my financials are public knowledge. When Marshall was questioning Fauci, he's citing Forbes, which was then my column. After that hearing, Marshall wrote the demand letter to National Institutes of Health asking for unredacted copies of 2019 and 2020 financial and ethics documents. And in the footnotes, he cited by name my column at Forbes. Within 48 hours, he got those records. We had been asking for those records for a year at that time, and this was the first time the unredacted records from 2019 had been produced, and the first time at all the 2020 record had been produced. And I quickly worked through the night, and I published the finding in my column at Forbes, and here's the findings. Dr. Anthony Fauci's net worth rivals $11 million. During the pandemic year of 2020, his household, him and his wife, they made $1.7 million, and that was broken down into his federal salaries, benefits, investment gains, and royalties. Two takeaways about this. Number one, government, when they spend your tax dollars, there are really rotten things going on. And number two, when you expose those things, government comes down hard. And my column at Forbes became an example of this. So I received, right after I published on Fauci's finances, I received an email from the executive editor at Forbes, somebody that I had never met before. I had written for Forbes for 8 years, 206 investigations, 16 million views. Just since 1-1 of 2019, on 112 pieces, we did 13 million views. These columns were averaging about 116,000 views a column. They were very popular. My first piece on Fauci did 900,000 views when we determined he was the most highly compensated. So I get the email from the executive editor at Forbes, her first line, 3 pieces on Fauci in 3 weeks, huh? Since the pandemic started, I published 92 investigations at Forbes, and only 6 were on Dr. Anthony Fauci. But I want to tell you how sensitive the Fauci financial information is. Because 24 hours later, the National Institutes of Health, 2 directors, 2 bureau chiefs, 2 of their top PR officers took time out at the peak of the Omicron wave, the peak of the pandemic, from defending the health of the country, to write a note to Forbes, to the top guy at Forbes, Randall Lane and myself, essentially saying, we don't like Andrzejewski's work, and we'd like you to do something about it. That email put me on the bad list at Forbes. Within 24 hours, my regular editor called me. He told me that I could no longer publish on Dr. Anthony Fauci. Our work was tip of the spear. Even today, it is the definitive analysis of the Fauci financials. Think about this. Forbes, rather than putting the full weight of the Forbes brand and platform behind going after and opening the books on the 1,200 pages of the Fauci financials, instead, they went after my column. And they terminated my column 10 days later. Now, I had a decision to make. You see, I'm an entrepreneur. I don't believe that you should break bad on a company. And I was a contributor at Forbes. I wasn't an employee, but nonetheless, over 8 years, I had a good relationship with Forbes, and they treated me very well. But I made the decision to tell the story because the American people need to know what is going on in this country. That these federal bureaus believe that they can pressure a mainstream news organization. Let's kind of walk through the war on transparency over at the NIH. Number one, defy the Freedom of Information Act. Slow walk all production. Use expensive taxpayer-paid litigation to keep taxpayers in the dark. defy congressional oversight by misleading Congress and senators. Try to silence your critics, buffalo their platforms, and then deplatform your critics. And that's what's going on at the National Institutes of Health. So I decided to be courageous and bold and tell the truth. And so I broke my story on Tucker Carlson tonight on Fox News. And that led to long-form deep dive interviews, for instance, on the Megyn Kelly Show, on Epic TV's American Thought Leaders. This week I'm going on Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s podcast. He wrote The Real Anthony Fauci. He wrote the New York Times bestselling book. And we've gotten a lot of press to educate the American people on the size, scope, and power of the federal government. All right, I just want to close with the following story. I had the good fortune when I founded OpenTheBooks.com and dedicated my life to public service in 2011 to meet a legendary United States senator. And his name is Dr. Tom Coburn. And he passed about 2 years ago. But when I met Dr. Coburn, he in 2013, he was on the Time 100 Most Influential Persons list. Here was a small state U.S. senator from Oklahoma, and yet he had risen to the Time 100 list because of transparency and accountability. You see, in 2006, Coburn partnered with then-Illinois Senator Barack Obama to write the legislation, the Google Your Government Act, to open the federal checkbook for the first time in history, and that's what makes our work today even possible. What his colleagues in the U.S. Senate called Dr. Coburn, Dr. No, because he used the Senate rules thousands of times to stop pork barrel expenditure projects. What he couldn't stop, he embarrassed his colleagues. He did a waste book report once a year. So Coburn was a champion of transparency and accountability. And it's big shoes to fill at our organization at OpenTheBooks.com. When Coburn left the Senate, he told the following story. See, he didn't really like being a senator. He liked delivering babies back in his small town in Oklahoma, and he delivered about 3,000 babies. And he said, on the law of large numbers, sometimes there would be a delivery that would get in trouble. And you knew you had a problem when the baby's heartbeat, which was oftentimes 160, 170 beats a minute, would drop to 50 or 60 beats a minute. Coburn said, at that moment, you had 3 minutes to make a decision to save the life of the mother, to save the life of the baby. He said you had options. You could use the forceps and pull the baby out. You could use the vacuum extractor. You could make the decision to put the mother up on the table, cut a hole in her belly, and take the baby by C-section. But Coburn said, you had to make a decision, and you had 3 minutes to do it. And Coburn said, America right now, on spending, waste, and the national debt, this is our 3 minute moment. And we have to take action or we're gonna lose the baby. Thank you, I'm open for questions.
Folks, we have time for just a couple of questions, so please come line up right here. Make sure you say your name and where you go to school.
Hi there. My name is Jacob. I go to the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. So I'm a lifelong Illinois, and I very much so remember when Rob Blagojevich was being prosecuted, and now I see a lot of conservative politicians kind of embracing him. What do you think about those kinds of politicians and, you know, their kind of embrace of him?
So there's a video. I addressed the Hillsdale National Leadership Seminar down in Naples, Florida on February 20th of 2020. And that was actually 1 day after President Trump pardoned Rod Blagojevich, if memory serves. So I got the same question. Nobody had much to do, obviously, during the economic lockdowns of the pandemic. So I think they all watched YouTube, and the video has 3.7 million views on it, and if you watch it, you'll never get that 50 minutes back in your lifetime. However, Donald Trump didn't call me. If he did, here's what I would have told him. I would have said, Mr. President, Illinois is the Super Bowl of corruption, and when the federal prosecutors finally indict and convict one of our governors, don't let him go. And that would have been my message.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks. My name is Kyle Clare. I'm from the University of Iowa. I'm glad you brought up Tom Coburn, because I was going to ask, because one of the things he did back in 2005 is there's an infamous project called the Bridge to Nowhere in Alaska, where it was basically a bridge to a town of like 100 people, and it was going to be millions and millions of dollars to build this bridge. And he tried to take that spending out of the budget. And when he did that, both of Alaska senators came to the floor, and one of them actually screamed that he was not going to back down. He was going to have this bridge to nowhere no matter what, and he was not going to back down. And I think a part of spending is that there's a lot of earmarks. And when it comes to taking things out of our budget, the senators of those states are expected to stand up for their states and not take away funding from their states for their projects. So how do we get rid of spending when we have that system in the Senate where senators are going to fight for more spending for their states?
Excellent question. Okay, so let's kind of break that down a little bit. I want to put a little extra color on that Coburn, Alaska Bridge to Nowhere story. So Ted Stevens, which was the Republican U.S. Senator from Alaska, does barrel down the aisle that night, screaming at Coburn. Coburn's a freshman from Oklahoma, and he's using the Senate rules to stop Stevens' bridge. And Coburn stood firm. Stevens said, you're going to lose the vote tonight. And Coburn knew he was going to lose it. And they did. He lost that vote something like 17-82 that night. But Coburn knew that when the American people woke up in the morning, that they would be angry at spending projects like that. And he correctly called that. But there was retribution because Coburn stood up. The Senate stripped Coburn of his ability to practice medicine back in his home district. There is a cost to these things. All right, now I want to answer your question about earmarks. So Nancy Pelosi decides to float the idea to bring back earmarks last spring. So 1 year ago, Pelosi as speaker floats. So Coburn and Obama successfully put a moratorium on earmarks in the House, in the Senate for 10 years. The currency of corruption. An earmark is a member pet project that's used to, stuck in a piece of legislation, used to bribe the legislator for their vote. It is legal corruption. And what does it do? It codifies the power of the House Speaker, Nancy Pelosi. So the Democrats approve this in an open caucus. The Republicans take a secret vote a year ago. And lo and behold, in the secret vote, it passed by like 17 votes. So here's the inside story as to what happened. You had 23 newly elected, in November of 2020, House freshmen, Republican, that flipped and voted for earmarks. So on the 2020 election, they ran as fiscal conservatives, and it took them 5 or 6 months for Pelosi to turn these Washington, D.C. outsiders into insiders. Nancy Pelosi, in the first iteration of the infrastructure bill, put nearly $400 million worth of earmarks for those newly elected 23 House freshmen. You just had a bill pass with 92 pages, I believe, if my memory serves, 92 pages of earmarks in this latest omnibus budget bill. And those are Republicans and Democrats feeding off of those member pet projects in their districts.
So how do we stop that and get rid of that?
Well,
that's you know.
So you need to hold them accountable for their votes and for their decisions. And look, if you're a Republican voting for earmarks and taking earmarks, I think it's an election issue. I think it's an election issue in your own district. I think they have missed the reading on especially their primary voters, that Republican primary voters, they don't like that type of behavior. I think it's a loser at the ballot box, and they've they don't understand where the base is.
Yes, well, thank you.
Yep.
Before I get to my question, first of all, how can the Senate strip a man of his medical license?
Well, the Senate sets the rules, and so they didn't strip him of his medical license. But as a United States senator, they stripped him of the ability to practice medicine.
Ah, okay. So now to my question. How did these records originally become closed? Was it the state legislature by vote, judicial fiat, bureaucracy? Does it depend on the state, et cetera? I was just wondering if you could speak to that. How did these originally become closed?
Which, like the office of vice president?
Just in general, whether it be discretionary spending, salaries. How did those sort of things become closed in the first place?
Closed?
Closed, like not available to the public.
Okay, so let's just walk through some of the examples that I used in my talk, like the Office of Vice President. So in the Clinton administration, there's a junior staffer over at the Department of Justice that writes a memo. Obviously, with a predetermined outcome. And they say the Office of Vice President is not subject to the Freedom of Information Act. And then nobody sued on it, and so that becomes kind of the operating policy. So that's in terms of the vice president. We want to sue on that. In terms of the Federal Reserve, what they do is they cite, so look, you and I, this is what we all have to understand. You and I own, and we've paid for, all of this public information. Someone's salary, a vendor payment, all of it. So when the Federal Reserve says they won't give you anything like that, they're violating federal statute. You know, I talked about how it's constitutional, Article 1, Section 9, but you have a federal statute called the Freedom of Information Act. It's a statutory process you and I use to take possession of data we already own and we already paid for. They don't own it. We do. In America, the citizen is sovereign. So we follow this statutory process. The Federal Reserve turns around and says, there are exemptions to the Federal Freedom of Information Act based on privacy. So they cite privacy exemptions, that the salary of 98% of their employees is private. We vehemently disagree. It's a terrible precedent, and we have to sue them for it. Okay.
Hi, Adam. My name is Corbin Larkin. I go to the University of Wisconsin-La Crosse, but I grew up in a small town called Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. It's about 10 miles from the border of Illinois. And my family has a lot of friends who have a home in Illinois, Chicagoland area, but also have one in Lake Geneva. And the last 2 years, a large majority of them have been selling their home in Illinois and moving to Wisconsin full-time. They don't want anything to do with what they call the sinking ship of Illinois. So what is the biggest problem in Illinois right now, and what is, if you can bring it down to one change that has to happen, what would it be?
Yep. So the biggest problem in Illinois is unfunded pension liabilities, where politicians conferred and promised unsustainable benefits on public employees. The public employees, through their unions, gave massive political cash, so you have this unholy alliance that's taken place in Illinois. And I want to put it in stark terms. So in Illinois, the unfunded pension liabilities rival $300 billion. And so what that means to a family of four is that they owe more in the unfunded pension liabilities for public employee retirements than what they earn in an entire year. That's why your friends are saying that it's unsustainable, because it certainly looks like we've passed the Rubicon, right? Okay, the number one thing that needs to happen immediately is hard caps on property taxes in Illinois. You say, well, how can that help? All right, follow me on this. So it's a two-step process. One is you bring the unfunded liabilities back to the school districts who conferred the benefits. So in the property tax-rich six-county area, most of the unfunded liability was conferred by those districts, yet all the other taxpayers across the state are responsible for the misspending up in the Chicagoland area. So you first bring the unfunded pension liabilities local. Step two, you cap property taxes. Okay, so right now Illinois has a property tax cap law. It's got 26 exemptions. The exemptions became the rule, and they can just basically hike your property taxes. So what that means is that the unions are able to hold the kids hostage in the classroom on salary negotiations. They can strike. And when you have that leverage, then you can get large increases in your salary above inflation, above population growth. So the idea is cap property taxes, eliminate the 26 exemptions, everything has to go under the cap, you make it reasonable, you can increase the cap by inflation or population growth, if any. Okay, so what that means is a school district has to live like you live at home. Last year's budget plus inflation. That's how people live. That's how they live. If they want more than that, they can persuade you. They can go out on referendum and take a vote, right? Okay, so what that does is it puts pressure to reform the pension system. Because property taxes are capped, all the massive pension liabilities local, there's no money to pay the pensions, the retirees aren't going to be paid. You force the moment. So then there are other options that local districts could do. There's a whole range of options at that point, but you force the moment because the current system, nobody's going to be left here to live anymore under the current system. So there has to be a reform moment. We need to force the reform moment. So now the trick with that is to get that down into a 3-second, a 5-second, and a 30-second response, because otherwise it won't sell. Thank you.